Ah oui. Welcome to the ninth class of this basic course in sketch programming. Please look at the spreadsheet. Okay, there is a list of names. Okay, this is here is the exercises that you delivered to us. And in this column is the names. So if you have sent exercises for us and your name is not here, please let us know. Okay? Oh, you have that? Can you give me? Okay, of course your name is not there, but there's no problem. Okay, that's it. Okay, in this class we are going to discuss some remarks about some results we saw in the last lecture, and after that we are going to solve the list. Okay. Where is it? Oh no, this is the wrong computer. Where is it? Okay. Let me put this here. Okay, the last lecture we were working essentially with a problem like this. Okay, as you may remember, this function g is convex, function c is also convex, and we are defining this value function as the optimal value of this problem. Okay. We are using here the infimum because maybe there is no minimizer for that problem. As we have saw the last lecture, this problem v, this function v is convex, and we were working a little with a sub-gradient of that function. Okay. After making some computations and things like that, we arrived to this inequality in the middle, and this inequality in this extreme, and we defined the dual function as a function by this. Okay, this is called the dual function that depends on the multiplier mu, okay, that is called the dual variable. From this point, okay, we can obtain some interesting results. for example, remark. It can be a remark or even a proposition. Okay. Well, we know that for fixed x, we know that this is less or equal than this for every dual variable mu greater or equal than zero. Okay, this is called the wake duality. Okay, and because of this, we can ask about what is this, the supremum of x mu greater or equal than zero, that we know that this is less or equal than vx. Okay, and maybe this optimization problem has solutions. Okay, this this problem is called the dual problem. Okay, and if it has solution, we call that solution the dual solution problem, the dual solution of the problem. Okay, maybe even in the optimal value of this problem, maybe is strictly below this of this quantity. And then the difference we call the gap, the duality gap. Okay. What's interesting at this point is if If we know that assume that there is a subgradient of the value function at the point x. Okay, this is a very special case. You can assume that, and if there is no duality gap, duality. Okay. Okay. Under these two assumptions, we are going to find interesting interesting results. Okay. I am not saying that the primal problem has solutions. I am not saying that the dual problem has solutions. I am only saying that that there exists some subgradient for this value function at point x, and that there is no duality gap. Okay. From that, we can arrive to what? Okay. Since there is no duality gap, well, I am going to copy this result here. Since this that is equal by definition to this here, to this thing here, plus c minus x transpose me. Okay, I am going to put a bar here. Okay. Okay, since there is no duality gap, then we know that this quantity is equal to this other quantity. Oh, no, no, wait a moment. No, well, we should have, there's no duality gap then. Let me see. Okay. There's no, well, okay. If there's no duality gap, okay, okay, we know that this is great. Let me see this. Well, then the supremum of this thing here, oh, sorry. We should have something like this, okay? Because there is no duality gap, okay? So the supremum of this, all this should be equal to v of x. And we are asking about this stuff here. Let me think a little about this. Oh, wait. Something like this, okay. Well, actually, I was trying to not to remake all the computation we made the last time. But if you remember the last time, here we had some results. Okay. Oh, okay. Here, remember for doing this. We have taken this subgradient at this point, And actually, we were not asking any assumption about the existence of this minimizer, but we used a minimizing sequence. And after that, we have shown that. Oh, that's a very bad thing. What we have shown was that actually that this result was that essentially we had obtained this this result using all these steps. Do you remember that we had that this this complementarity condition in an asymptotic way, and we saw that in the limit that minimizing sequence was solving this problem, and then that will leave us to this result. Oh, that's not a. That is not so elegant, but what we wanted to say is that if we have under these two assumptions, that if we have no duality gap and if we have this this subgradient, then we can ensure that that subgradient is going to be the solution of the dual problem. Okay, so what I wanted to say is that if there is no duality, if this is a subgradient and there is no duality gap, then this is a dual solution. That's what I wanted to show. Actually, that is, I am quite sure that we can obtain that result from these inequalities. How we can show that? Let me see. Okay. Okay, this is what we wanted to show, okay? And from this, actually, it's quite simple. Since we have this this relationship, we know that zero, it's very similar to what we made the last time, okay? Plus mu bar, for example, okay? From that, we know that zero belongs to this subgradient. Let's see. Plus, I don't know, maybe something like this. Z minus x transpose mu bar, okay, when z is equal to x, okay, that's the same thing. That means that x bar x solves this problem, the infimum of z of v of z, okay, plus z minus x transpose mu bar, okay. We have that. From that, we know two things. First thing is that since x solves this problem, we know that this happens here. Okay, since this is the optimal value of that, and x solves this problem, we have that here plus x minus x transpose. Okay, so this is vx var, vx, okay? So okay, and since all the values of the dual values are less or equal than this, we know that mu bar solves the dual problem. Okay, and since these two things are equal, then actually there is no duality gap. So actually, the result we have found is that if we have a subgradient, then this this dual variable solves it, is a dual solution, and there is no there is no duality gap. Okay, that's the result I wanted to show you. Oh my God, I am getting old. My brain is not working as used to work. And actually, what we have is also the other direction. I mean that if mu bar is a dual solution, and if there is no duality gap, okay, then what we want to show is this. Okay, and again, this result came easily from that inequality. Okay, now this comes from here. Since we know that, okay, okay, and we know this. Oh, this is one I think in before. Okay, this means that mu bar solves the dual problem. Okay, this is the definition of this dual function at the variable mu bar, and we are assuming that there is no duality gap. Then actually here we are going to have an equality because there is no duality gap. from this we want to show that the negative of this dual solution is in the subdifferential of the function v. So how we can see that? Okay, from that we know that vx, okay, is less or equal than any other variable like this. Okay, this is for every c. So what this shows is that x bar, that x is the solution of this optimization problem. That means that 0 belongs to this subdifferential. Okay, at c equal x, and from this we obtain easily this result. Okay, so what we have is that the set of solutions of the dual variable is exactly the negative of the elements of the subdifferential of the value function. Okay. And at this point, we didn't make any special assumptions about the existence of solutions or anything like that. Okay, so these results are quite general and are going to be very useful anytime you need existing results. Of course, we don't know about the assumptions we need to make in order to ensure the existence of solutions. And here we have a theorem that makes some conditions to ensure the existence of solutions. Okay, so here we are assuming that at a point x, the optimal value is finite. That means it's not map plus infinite. That means that the problem is feasible, and it's not minus infinite. That means that and on the feasible set, the object in function is bounded. With those two assumptions, we can ensure that this is real, okay? And the other assumption we need is to prove the existence of this variable y, such that the constraint is held in a strict way. That's called the Slater condition. And under those two assumptions, we can show that actually the dual problem will have solutions. Maybe the primal not. Do you remember that the last class we saw some examples where the primal problem didn't have solutions and the dual have? Okay, and there is no duality gap. The proof of this, I'm going to give the proof of this this theorem because in the proof we are going to see some other interesting properties of this of these functions. Okay, so well, another remark. Okay, well, since we know that cy is strictly less than x, okay, then there exists epsilon greater than zero such that cy is less than z for every z in that open ball. Okay, I know that this is, for example, C. Then I know that there is a small ball here of radius epsilon, where every point at this in this ball is holds this strict inequality. From that point, we have the following. I think we call this problem like P. The problem. What's the name of the problem? Okay. Remembering that this problem that depends on x is called Px. Okay. I am going to use that. That notation. We have the following. And so this y is feasible for all z in that wall. Okay, we know that it is feasible because we know that for all elements at this wall z, we have this inequality. So this y is feasible. And then we know that this optimal value cannot be plus infinite, okay? Because there are feasible points, okay? Maybe this can be minus infinite. It could be, okay? Maybe for some value z, the optimal, the object function is unbounded from below on the feasible set, and then this could be minus infinite. But at least in this ball, it's not plus infinite, okay? And what we want to show is that actually in this ball, the optimal value is a real number, okay? And showing that in this ball the optimal value v is a real number, we will have that we have a convex function. We know that the value function v is a convex function that's going to be finite in this ball. Then it is subdifferentiable at all points on this ball, in particular in, at the point x, okay? And since, and if it is subdifferentiable at the point x, okay, it has a subgradient, and then we can show from the remarks before that those subgradients will be solutions of the dual problem, and there will be no duality gap. Okay, so that's the proof of the theorem. But even more, since we are inside an open wall, that that subdifferential is going to be bounded. It's going to be a compact set, actually. So we will know that at least for all points in this open wall, the solutions of the dual problems will be all of them compact. Okay, so. That's an interesting thing. okay, that's what we want to do. We already know that they are not plus infinite, okay? And what we want to show is that they are going to be finite, actually. How we can prove that? How can prove that this is going to be finite? Let me see. We already know that we know at least that at this point that problem is finite. Okay. Okay. From this. Okay. How can I? Well, since we are in an open ball, I am sure that at some point, maybe here, okay, I am going to find a point z hat, okay. There exists a point z hat. On the other hand, there exists. Point z hat in that wall, okay, x such that is strictly less than x. It's easy to see, okay? It's only to move a little here, and we will have a point like that. Okay, so actually, since I have a point of this, I can find another small ball here. Okay, and there exists another epsilon greater than zero, okay, such that that other ball is contained in the original ball, okay, and is this strictly less than x for l for all z on this ball, okay. I can find a small ball here such that all elements of this small ball are strictly below from x. And what we are going to prove now is that at least in this on this small ball, the value function is finite. Okay, we already know that in this big ball, the value function is not plus infinite, but maybe it's still minus infinite in some points. But what we will prove now is that at least in this on this small ball, they are not minus infinite, so they are finite. Okay. For that, how we can prove? Okay. Assume. Then assume that y-hat is feasible. Y-hat is feasible for the problem associated to some z-hat node, another ladder. Z for Z in this small ball, okay? Then we know that since this is feasible for this problem, this is less or equal than Z, for example, okay? And this is strictly less than X, okay? So this point is feasible for Px, for the original problem, okay? Since it is feasible for this problem Px, we know that Vx should be less or equal than g on y, okay? Because this is the optimal value for all feasible points on this problem. From that, we know that Vx should be less or equal than Vz, okay? And this is not plus infinite, okay? And this is not, oh, sorry, minus infinite, plus infinite, okay? So Vz is optimal, now is finite for all z in this small ball. Okay, so now already now what we have is the value function is not plus infinite in this big ball, and in this small ball it's finite. Now what we want to prove is that actually it is finite in this whole ball. Okay. And the proof is quite easily, quite easy. I am not going to give that proof, but you can do it at home very easily because we are running out of time. Okay. Assume that here there is a point, some point z, such that the value, the optimal value, is minus infinite. We want to prove that that point doesn't exist, okay? But we know that at this ball, all the points are finite, okay? So you can look at this line, okay? And then there will be something like some point here that is in the middle, that is in the middle of the segment, but this is still inside of this small ball, okay? And you know that in this segment the function is convex, okay? And we will get a contradiction because why? Imagine that you have the graph of this point z here, okay? Here is the point z that is minus infinite, okay? That is minus infinite. This is finite, I know. Well, okay, here is a ball that everything is finite, maybe something like this, okay? And here we have another point that I am going to call this point W, for example, okay? That is finite. But we know that since the function is convex, the epigraph is convex, okay? And since it is convex, well, I know that this point, for example, belongs to the epigraph, okay? Well, imagine that the graph of this function is something like this, okay? I don't know how is it, but it's convex. Okay, so this point belongs to the epigraph, then the segment belongs to the epigraph, okay? So this point here should belong to the epigraph, okay? So that means that this point is greater or equal than Vw, okay? I'm going to call this alpha, for example. Then alpha should be greater or equal than Vw. But since this is minus infinite, okay, V is minus infinite, I can take another segment below here. So I can do the same thing, but now this value alpha is here, and I can continue doing that because I can go to the infinite, and this value alpha is going to minus infinite as well, and that will contradict the fact that this is finite. Okay, so that is quite easy. Another thing that we can note as well at this point is the following. If you assume that you have a ball around x, where the okay, the question was if x at this point is the optimal value of v. The answer is no. Because on the problem here, the definition of this problem, we are defining this this optimization, this function as the optimal value of this optimization problem. Okay, so for each x, you have something like this. For fixed x, you have an optimization problem, and for that optimization problem, you can define the dual problem. You can ask about the subdifferential of this function v at this point x. Okay, you can do all those things. So all the theorems that we have so far are for a fixed x.
So what you have shown is that for a small precipitation around x, the optimal value remains finite. There is no duality yet.
Yeah. Under the assumption. Under the assumption that for this fixed x, okay, you have this guy, okay, and under this assumption again, we are fixing this x, okay, and we have some guy that is such that this inequality is strict, okay. Under those assumptions, we have shown that actually for that x there exists a small ball, okay, where all values optimal values v are finite for all of them, okay? And because of that, since the function v is convex, okay, we know that there exists it is subdifferentiable at every point here, in particular to x. And since it is subdifferentiable, we know that the dual value has solutions, and there is no duality gap for x here, and actually for all other points in this small ball. Okay, that's what we have shown. Okay. So okay, all what we have done until this point, okay, was to prove that actually under this assumption here, we can prove that actually there exists a ball like this, because what we wanted to prove, we are trying to prove this theorem. Okay. Okay, so what we want to prove is that the dual function has a solution and there is no duality gap. How to do that? Well, from the remarks before, we know that if we have some subgradient of the value function, that the existence of subgradient is enough to ensure that actually there exists a solution of the dual function and no duality gap. So that is why we were doing all this. But what we found is that actually there is more than that. We can prove that the the subdifferential at this point, for example, is compact. That means that the dual solutions are compact because the dual solutions are the negative of the subdifferential. Okay. And in the other hand, if you know that around this point x, the value function is finite, for example, okay, assuming that another remark here. Assuming that v of z is finite for all z in a ball around x, okay. If you have that, you know that then there exists some x hat, okay, on that ball, such that that x hat is strictly below x. That z hat is strictly below x, okay? You know that. And, of course, you know that this is finite, okay? Because we are assuming that we have a ball like that. Since that, we know that this is feasible. Okay? Otherwise, this value would be plus infinite. It's feasible. Okay? And if some y hat is feasible, it's feasible for okay, if I have that there is some point that is feasible, we know that already that that point exists, okay? We will have this. Okay, because there's a point feasible. But we know that this happens. So there is a point that satisfies the Slater condition. Okay. So if you have if you know that the value function is finite around in some ball, then you know that actually there should be some point that is satisfying the Slater condition. Okay. So that's a strong result. Okay. Oh no, this is not again. Oh, we are running out of time. Oh no. Let me see. No more. No. Okay. Okay, this is the list we gave to you so that you can solve them, and we are going to solve it. We are going to solve it now. Well, we are not first. We are not going to solve this last question because question what number? Question 8, because there is a discussion of the about this problem in the libro in the book of Shapiro, Rosinski, and Densheva. Okay, actually that is in the introduction part. Okay. So if you have any doubt, you can go to to read that part, and okay, there's no problem. Here, well, the first part, how, for the two-stage linear programming problem, assume that the random vector exists has finite support. Using the one-stage equivalent formulation, deduce the optimality conditions for the two-stage problem. Okay, on the previous lectures with Claudia, you obtained some optimality conditions for the two-stage problem, okay? And from the from the fact that that this is this I'm going to put CK for the scenarios, okay? This is the first stage problem, and the two stage problem is something like this. Pi. No. What's the variable you use here? Q? Yeah, it's Q, if I am not wrong. Here you put something like this. Maybe this is random. This is okay. Here we have the two-stage problem. Okay, and we know that I don't know M. Okay, we know that this random vector has finite support. And we know that this this problem is equivalent. It's equivalent to this one stage problem here on X, okay? In this case, now wait. In these two sets of variables, I'm sorry, here I was forgetting the expected value. Here we will take transpose here. Okay, well, here transposed. We can assume even that maybe this vector is also random, okay? For this, and of course, okay, so we already know that this is a big linear problem that is completely equivalent to this other two-stage problem. We have shown that already, and since this is an expected value, the random vector is has a finite support, we can actually replace this for a sum. M pk, where pk is the probability of happening this realization, okay? Or having that realization. Okay, so here is everything is linear, And we know that there exists some multipliers. Okay, the point here is that there exists here, for example, some multiplier. Let's call it lambda k maybe. Here there will be other multipliers, mu k, something like that. And then we can write at this point the KKT conditions, okay? The optimality conditions are, well, the gradient of this of the objective function is going to be something like C here, and on the other points are going to be P1, Q1, for example, P2, Q2, Tn here, Pm, Qm. Okay. A big vector here. This needs to go 0. And after relaxing, here we will have another multiplier. I was forgetting. Here we have another multiplier, a name for this. Let's call it lambda hat, okay? And here another multiplier I am going to call a mu hat. Then after relaxing this this constraint, we will have something like a transpose lambda hat, zeros at this point, plus, now relaxing this these constraints here, what we will have we'll have something like a TK transposed, and here, well, some zeros maybe here. At some point we will find some WTK transposed and more zeros here. All this multiplying multiplier, and we will sum these vectors. Okay, this is the K entry. Plus, okay, well, now what we need to relax are these two constraints here, okay? So, we will have something like this. Here I am going to find minus mu here, okay? Here I am going to find minus mu 1, minus mu 2, minus mu m. Okay? And complementarity conditions. The complementarity conditions are that, mu bar is greater or equal than 0 is orthogonal to 2x, that is greater or equal than 0 as well, and the other constraints here. And 0. Okay. Using these complementarity conditions, we can substitute these values from here. Okay, we know all these values here. Then we can substitute those values in these complementarity conditions. then actually we will have this something like this. Oh, zero should be what's going to be here. Oh, C plus A transposed lambda hat. Okay. Plus lambda k. And this should be something like this. Oh, this is for k equal 1 to 2m. And in a similar way, we will have something like this other point. We'll have pk, qk, plus okay, wk transpose lambda, no, it's not hat here, only that, yeah, zero. This is for k 2m. Okay. Here, what is interesting is that for obtaining the same optimality conditions for the second stage problem, since these probabilities are all of them greater than zero, we can set lambda k equal pk for some other value that's going to we are going to call pi k. Okay, so at this point, what we will have here is that we will have pk, pi k, and p at that point. And since all these values are positive, they are not going to affect these complementarity conditions. So we will have something like this. And those are the optimality conditions for the second stage problem. So in that sense, we can, I am forgetting something here. We can deduce all those optimality conditions for the second stage, for the two stage problems. Okay, what I mean is that the only thing that was important at this point, because everything was more or less straightforward, is that for obtaining the optimality conditions for the two stage problems, we need to choose these multipliers here, as that probability another multiplier. Okay, and that's all what we needed. Okay, it's quite straightforward. Here the second question was quite easy as well, because we are assuming now that the problem, the vector C has finite support, okay? Has finite support. Has finite support, okay? And we are asked to show that under this assumption, a relatively complete recurse is equivalent to ask for this, okay? But the definition of a relatively complete recurse okay, if has has a relative complete recurse. Means that for all feasible point, no, for all not, yeah, for all feasible point X, freeze stage decision variable, the second stage problem is feasible for almost every realizations of the random vector C. Okay, but since the random vector has a finite support, that means that all those realizations count because all of them has a positive probability. Okay, since all realizations, few realizations of C have a positive probability we have that the second stage problem is feasible for all C. Okay, that means that since the problem that defines this optimal value is feasible, it cannot be plus infinite. Maybe minus infinite, but not plus infinite. Okay. And the other direction is clear because the definition only asks about almost everywhere holding. Okay. Since we know here that for all realization of C works, then it's clear. Question 3. Okay. Okay, so here we have the definition of this second stage problem that is fixed recurse, okay? Or maybe here is something like this. This is only W here. This is the second stage problem. And we want to prove that all these three statements are equivalent. Okay? So let's go. From A to B, we are assuming that the problem has a complete recurse. If it has a complete recurse, that means that well, let's assume that W is a matrix with these dimensions, okay? So if the problem has complete recurse, that means that this set here, WY, such that Y is greater or equal than zero. Of course, Y belongs to Rm. This is exactly Rn. That means that it has complete recurse. Okay. From this, we want to show that the dual problem, the feasible set of the dual problem, is bounded for all Q. Okay. And since we know that this set is going to be all pi's that belong to Rn, such that transposed is equal to Q. Okay. We want to prove that this set is bounded. I can erase that. Okay. By contradiction, assume that this set here is unbounded. It's unbounded. Then we know that there exists a sequence pi k, okay, on this set, such that the length of those vectors goes to plus infinity. Okay, como they are dual feasible, we know that this should happen. Circle then Q, okay, and we can do this here and this here, and there will be no difference, okay? And since this set this sequence here is bounded. Okay, it's bounded because all of them has length 1, okay, they are unitary. There exists a subsequence, okay, kj a subsequence that is converges to some vector rho, okay? Okay, note that rho has length 1. Now, using this sequence on this inequality, we will have that the limit W transpose. is going to be less or equal than the limit of Q KJ, okay? But since this is a subsequence and the original one was convergent to plus infinite, this subsequence also is going to plus infinite, and since Q is fixed, we will have that this limit that is equal to W rho less or equal than zero. Okay. Remember that this rho belongs to Rn. Okay. Okay. Finally. Finally, since we have a complete recurse here. Since we know this happens, okay, there exists y bar on Rn such that rho is equal to this. Actually, this is greater or equal than zero. Then what we will have? Okay. Okay, so since this is less or equal than zero, and this is greater or equal than zero, the inner product is going to be less or equal than zero, okay? But this inner product is actually this one, okay? But this is equal to the norm rho squared. So this norm squared is less or equal than zero. That means that rho should be zero. But we know that the length of rho is one, so that's a contradiction. Okay. That's a contradiction. So. That contradiction comes from the fact that we have assumed that this set was unbounded. Okay. From part B to C. That's easy as well. By contradiction again. By contradiction. By contradiction. Assume there exists. There exists some pi hat such that different from zero, okay? Different from zero such that this is less or equal than zero. Okay, then for every t greater or equal than zero, we will have that. That this will be less or equal than V for every pi that is in this set Q, pi Q, okay? If I take that this pi on the dual feasible set, I know that for this pi, okay, I know that this happens equal V, okay? And since I know that this inequality holds, and I multiply by t, now negative, when I put this t here, there will be no difference, and I can add to this inequality, I will have this, this inequality. Okay, that means that that means that pi plus t pi hat belongs to pi q. Okay. For every t greater or equal than zero, and since this element is non-zero, that implies that this set is unbounded. Okay, and it's a contradiction. Okay, so that proves that this inequality has a unique solution that is, of course, zero. Okay, now from C to A. Again, we want to prove that this set here is, of course, this is contained on Rn, okay? What we want to prove is that they are actually the same. For that, assume that there exists some point, I don't know how to call z, that belongs to Rn minus okay, and we need to write a contradiction. This is a con, this is a closed, convex cone. Okay, since that is a closed convex cone, you can use, we can apply a strong separation theorem. Okay, that means that there exists some alpha bar that belongs to Rn such that that z alpha is greater than some value. I don't know, eta, and this is greater or equal than that alpha bar wy for all y greater or equal than zero. Okay, from this point we can prove that eta is should be greater or equal than zero, and that this other inequality also holds because it's a cone, okay? Since it's a cone, if this were positive for some value of y, you can multiply by a constant, by a non-negative number t here, and that can become bigger than eta, and that's impossible. Okay, so that means that W transpose alpha bar y is less equal than 0 for every y that is greater equal than 0. Okay, that that implies that this w alpha bar should be less or equal than 0. Okay, so alpha bar is a solution of this system. Okay, and since there it has only one solution, that means that alpha bar should be 0. But if alpha bar is equal to 0, I am going to have 0 here, 0 here, and a strict inequality in the middle. That's a contradiction. Okay? Contradiction. Okay, we have 7 minutes to solve the whole list. I think we can do it. Okay, so, yes. Should be different from 0, only that. Okay, so what's the question then? Okay, okay, from the strong separation theorem, okay. Okay, that's true. The strong separation theorem already says that alpha bar is different from 0, okay. It should be, because otherwise you cannot have this inequality, a strict inequality. Number 4. Well, for number 4 it's going to be quite easy, because we already know that, well, okay, everything here is it's convex, okay, so this optimal value is convex as well. And if you have, and if the dual problem has a unique solution, that means that the sub-differential of this function has a unique element, okay? And if the sub-differential of a convex function has a unique element, that means that the function is differentiable. And okay, so that means that this function is differentiable, and its derivative in this case is minus the dual solution. Okay, and from that, since this is only a composite of a differential function, you can arrive to the expression of that. Okay, so it's not there's no difficulty on 4. 5. Oh, 5 is more interesting. Okay, this is a linear problem. Z is fixed, and these are random elements. And of course, the dual solutions will depend on the random vector C. Okay. And what we want to prove is that the dual solutions that will depend on C can be expressed in this way. Okay. I think we can do it easily. The dual problem is going to be something like this. The dual problem is maximize what's going to be that Z transpose pi, okay? Pi should be less or equal than QC, okay? And only that. And okay, assume that is the primal solution. Okay, assume that you have a premise solution. We have so on the previous lectures that this primer solution can be that can be chosen as a measurable vector. Okay, the primer solution can be chosen as being measurable. Then you can see that this the dual solutions will be something like this. Pi such that this here happens, okay? It should be feasible for the dual problem, of course, because it's a solution. And this other thing should happen. Should be least or equal than, I think greater or equal than the primal optimal value. That means that should be something like this. Okay. Okay, so everything here is linear. The variables here are only are multiplying some vectors or matrices. So both of them are Cartesian functions. And if you define this as the maximum of those things, and the other should be okay. The maximum of Cartesian functions is also Cartesian functions. It's not a problem because the maximum of measurable function is measurable. The maximum of continuous function is continuous. So this is a Cartesian function, so, and that shows the problem. This is number 5. Number 6, I am not going to take that. Actually, that was my error because for number 6 it is necessary to use some strong theorems. I thought it was possible to solve it without without that, but I was wrong. No, but you know it's a line. For each, okay. The question was in this case this is a vector function, okay? So of course technically this is not a Cartesian function because there are vectors, but if you look line wise, each line is going to be a Cartesian function, okay? So you actually here you have a lot of Cartesian functions, each one for lines here. Well, this is a Cartesian function, so you have a finite number of Cartesian functions, and the maximum of Cartesian function is a Cartesian function, so there will be no problem. Question 7, there is a typo here. The transpose should be here, okay? That was quite natural because otherwise this is only a number and this expression would not make sense. Okay, the transpose should be here. And, well, let's do it in a minute because it's quite easy. Okay, number 7. By definition, the variance of this thing here is going to be the expected value of this here x minus this here x square, this one. Okay, this is equal to the expected value transpose x minus the expected value of, since x is fixed, okay, it's not random, the square, this is equal to, okay, this is call it a mu by the question here, so this becomes something like this. Okay, square, and of course these are two numbers and this is equal to expected value of transposed mu, okay, this is a number that is equal to this other number, okay. So this x, since it is not random, can be put outside this other as well, and you have the solution. As I have said, question 8 is there is a section in the book from Shapiro, Densheva, and Rusinski, so there will be no problem. Okay, so that was all. See you next. Well, I will not see you until the final part of the course that is going to be RISC. Okay, I think the next class is going to be given by Claudia or Wellington. Claudia, I think. Okay, so until the next time.